You are listening to the Gamer Watch Podcast.
Someone is furiously typing, and it's a music.
Sorry.
It's the guy bugging you again, Duncan.
It sounds like angry typing.
No, just talking about the Halo stuff reminded me of something to do with the multiplayer, so I was just writing it down to remember.
Oh my god.
Oh, I guess, and with that, it's welcome to Gamers Watch episode 47.
Again.
It's a bit downhill with the bingo again. It's literally just 4 and 7, 47.
Oh. Who can we complain to about that?
There must be a bingo committee, or just go around to your local, old people's home.
What the fuck is this?
Improve your bingo slang, please.
Oi, Agatha, sort it out.
Bitty bingo committee.
Yeah. Oh, anyway, I am Sean, and as always with me is Duncan.
Hey, great mates.
And this week we are blessed with the presence of Connor.
You all right, Governor?
And Paul.
I'm a little hard.
How's it going?
And we also asked Harry to sit this one out and scream into the void because it's a Halo episode. So nice Halo episode. I'll be quick with the housekeeping. If you enjoy this podcast, and even if you don't, be sure to follow us on Twitter, which is @GamersWatchCrew. Subscribe to us on YouTube, which is youtube.com/GamersWatch. Share it with your local rampant AI this week, and then also hit the. So I just read the bit. I was skimming over the script to get the main bits, and just saw touch yourself and tune in Mondays, 7:30 GMT, 2:30 Eastern, 1:30 Central.
I meant to write treat yourself. Oh fuck!
Oh, it can be a treat. Touch and a treat.
Same thing, innit?
Moisten your behind lips.
Yeah. Fuck her up.
Wipe the pillow.
Oh. And then, because you Australians only get recreational time at specific times, then just watch it whenever you can then.
Because they're all criminals, aren't they, Sean?
They are indeed. Drunks or criminals, or criminally drunk.
Oh, I'm dying here.
I say as I sip my beer. Right. Should we do the game awards before we crack on with Halo?
Yeah, get the shit out of the way.
Yeah, since I was last night. So yeah, last night at the time of recording was the game awards. And basically, if you didn't watch it, Hellblade 2 looks good. Psychonauts 2 got absolutely shafted in every category it was in. And then so did the Artful Escape. Anyone else want to say anything?
No,
I fucking... Oh, shit, I've broken something. I fucking hate the whole idea about them. It's just another E3. And the fact that Artful Escape didn't win, Best Audio or Soundtrack is a fucking nonsense. Nonsense it is. probably the kind of people that Jeff Garley's mates with. So,
We did apparently he opened with the whole speech thing, obviously addressing Activision, and then went straight into a trailer for a game by Quantic Dream, who are also rampant sexual offenders.
Has anyone watched that trailer for that Star Wars game?
Yeah, yeah.
It looks
good.
A fucking fever dream. I don't know what the fuck I was watching.
It doesn't look like it's just one of those. It strikes me as one of those trailers that they actually haven't figured out what the game's going to be yet. So they just put all the Star Wars shit in a trailer and they go, "There you go, that'll keep the fans happy."
those drums were cool from the Matrix, weren't they? Let's chuck them in as well.
I mean, for a trailer, it looks pretty good. If it was a Star Wars CGI movie or something like that, but yeah. Their games, they just play like Telltale games.
I was going to say, Quantic Dreams often don't make sense at times with their games as it is, so I don't know what they're going to do with Star Wars.
I imagine that with Star Wars and it being, I imagine they're going to have to fit into a specific story that they're told they have to follow. Well,
it's set in the High Republic, which is the new Star Wars, if that makes sense. They're kind of following the Skywalker saga. So I think it's in between current Star Wars and the Old Republic.
Yeah, but wasn't there Yoda in that trailer? Yoda was
in
that trailer.
I think,
get that.
I think there is a young Yoda as part of this, probably to tie it into. So some people,
I hope they're not trying to tie in the little baby Yoda from The Mandalorian.
Little Grogu.
Grogu. All the best. Little Grogu. but yeah, Psychonauts 2 was robbed. I was happy about It Takes Two though winning. Because that is unbelievable.
I can't remember his name, but the guy that creates the creator of that game, can you remember his name?
Joseph Fares.
Archel cracks me up, by the way. Did you see him getting his award?
No.
Yeah. I just want to say congratulations to Mr. Fuck the Oscars on his Game of the Year win.
Oh yeah, that was amazing. He walked out and was talking about like fuck the Oscars. This is better than the Oscars, he was saying.
Oh. I think someone put out on Twitter like they really wanted him to go on stage and shout out like fuck Bobby Kotick or something like that.
But he probably got told he couldn't say anything about that because on their advisory board sits an Activision fucking higher up.
Yeah, so it's ridiculous. Mm. I don't know why like Jeff Keighley's like this self-appointed super gamer. Like I don't understand how that's happened. He's right insufferable to
it. I was gonna say it seemed to start years ago when the whole I think it was Fox. It was one of those sort of American news programs. Done the whole sex scenes in Mass Effect thing, and he like basically put them in their place when they interviewed him about it. And since then, he's sort of gone up and up and up. I think that sort of seemed to be where it started for Jeff Keighley. But the Psychonauts 2 thing, I don't mind it not getting Game of the Year because It Takes Two also fully deserves it. But I don't get how it didn't get Best Narrative, because it's literally like I've never seen a game be able to do some of the things it done. I don't want to ruin it just in case anyone hasn't played it yet.
Yeah, I haven't finished it yet.
Some of the traits and like characteristics of some of the characters hasn't been done that well in any game before.
I honestly feel with Psychonauts 2, I've only played probably about half of it at this point, but it feels like a really high-end Pixar like movie like script. Like that to me, like I was sitting there and I was like, this feels like a really high-end movie that I would love to watch, like animated movie. It was the whole storyline is fantastic, and the way that the characters interact and stuff like that, and the way that it pulls from the original as well, it's brilliant.
So I think, is it Guardians of the Galaxy 1? And I'm playing that at the minute and it's very good. Like I like it, genuinely a brilliant game. But you know, Psychonauts 2 is just something different because it's not pulling from any source material. It's, you know, it's completely all out of Tim Schafer's mind. And like Sean, you wrote in your article, just like the amount of themes that it explores from like a mental health perspective. Mm. Amazing. I don't want to spoil it, but like, there was a mission we spoke about when we, you know, a couple of months ago. To do with like a band,
yeah,
and the way they approach like certain themes around that is absolutely brilliant game. But then talking about mental health, Hellblade 2, that trailer just looks just unbelievable.
Yep.
Like I almost like found it quite difficult to watch. So like Georgia suffers quite badly with anxiety, and a lot of it is to do with health. And there was a bit in the trailer where she sees a skeleton, and in her head, it was like the voice in her head said, "Oh, that'll be you one day." And I was like, "Oh, fucking hell, yeah, that's probably what Georgia feels like." So I did find it really uncomfortable to watch, but it just looked next level.
It was phenomenal. Like me and Zoe watched it last night, and we watched it like separate from the live stream. So we watched it on the Xbox YouTube channel before I started watching the live stream at stupid o'clock at night. And I actually had to go and double check that was gameplay, because it said gameplay on it, but I still did not believe it. Like the motion of the hair and everything, like it was so natural. And even her running, like, you know, games very much have that kind of like robotic run to the characters. Even now, I would suggest it's that kind of, you could tell it's a game, but it looked like CGI. It looked like CGI captured, like, but it was just amazing. Like it just blew my mind.
Yeah, there's actually a point where you can actually tell that it's gameplay. It's one of the points when she turns around. It's a slight bit of like jankiness to it, but obviously not too janky, that makes you like realize that is actually bloody gameplay, and it's unbelievably good. And another thing I just want to say, if there is still any debate out there that Xbox hasn't got the talent to make these games like The Last of Us or God of War, well, you can kiss that narrative goodbye, because this is a huge contender for those type of games.
I think this is a potential Game of the Year contender when it releases.
Oh, yeah. And if anyone hasn't played the first Hellblade, I urge you to go and play that. I gave that a must play for the parcel play I did on it.
I think I stopped playing that in the end because I think I just found it a bit much. But I think I'll go back and play it. But I was reading up about this trailer, and that big troll
human thing.
Giant.
I think it took him about 100 hours to create through like AI learning as well, because it, like the way it moved and kind of flopped down on the rocks, it looked real. It was a really properly unnerving kind of
crazy good,
because you kind of expect it to be like almost like a movie where it would like land in a certain way that you used to, like, you put his arm out, but the way his arm was kind of tucked underneath him and he fell down, I was blown away by that trailer.
The technology that Xbox are using in their games at the moment, Microsoft like studios are using in their games, you know, with like the scanning from Forza and, you know, the scanning that they've been doing with Hellblade. I watched some of the videos on that. It's just showing you where gaming's going to go. You know, it's I'm very thankful for the gaming community that Microsoft isn't trying to patent that.
It's not only that, though, it's the audio, like, recordings that go with it, the effort they go to make the sounds the way they are, how good they are. It's crazy.
Ray traced audio.
That's why Forza won best audio design.
It's insane.
But also, there was another little thing that I actually haven't seen because, I didn't watch the Game Awards. I just woke up this morning, looked at my phone, and was like, you what? At Psychonauts 2 stuff, and just sort of put my phone down. Also, how did it not get a nomination for accessibility? That's the whole thing leading up to it.
Like, accessibility options to be able to turn on God mode if you, like, suffer with a point of accessibility, you can't do certain things.
Well, not just that, but, like, enabling God mode doesn't disable achievements as well. And I remember there was, like, loads of people were, like, kicking off a right stink about that before launch, and then it's just not even mentioned in the accessibility list for awards.
I think the thing that, like, Psychonauts loses out on is it is kind of a bit of a cult classic, and I think, you know, the kind of casual market, I suppose, to some extent, don't really focus on that kind of games. I just think that because it's not, you know, it's not like a flagship Xbox game or like for a specific console like Ratchet was for Sony, I think that because it's multi-platform, it's almost like fallen under the radar a little bit in regards to the wider gaming community, I would say.
I need to complete Psychonauts 2 really bad. Like, I just need to get back to it at some point.
It's so good.
Yeah, I think we'll have our Game of the Year episode early next year, I think. But that was my pick. Well, what other games that were announced? Because there were fucking hundreds of them.
There's so many. I've got a few notes for some of them. The new Space Marine game, Space Marine 2, that looked pretty interesting. They actually showed some gameplay for that as well, which I'm surprised, and that comes out next year. Actually used to paint Space Marines when I was younger, so it's something that's on my radar, is to play that. The new Suicide Squad game, I'm actually really sold on that now.
That
I was a bit
so
hesitant
fucking
at first.
The animations looked great.
I'm a huge DZ fan, so I'm absolutely looking forward to that. There was, shortly after that, I think they announced the Wonder Woman game.
Yeah, Warner Brothers threw out a lot.
Yeah. I'm thinking that Wonder Woman game that they announced is probably going to be like God of War-esque style game from Warner Brothers.
Well, apparently it's got the Nemesis system in it.
Is it?
From the Shadow of War. Because obviously they've, talking about patenting, like they patented that from the God of the Shadow of War thingies, Middle-Earth games.
Yeah.
So I completely agree on Suicide Squad though. That looks unbelievable.
Yeah, I'm excited for that.
A big one for me, as a massive Borderlands fan, was Tiny Tina's Wonderlands. I can't wait for that game.
I don't know, I'm not sold on that. I kind of got bored of Borderlands after Borderlands 2. Borderlands 2 was so good. I played some of the pre-sequel and I just couldn't get into that. And I was like, it's hard to top how good Borderlands 2 was.
I absolutely agree with you. I think Borderlands 2 was kind of peak Borderlands. Like, even the third one, like, I got the Ultimate Edition or whatever it was called and played the DLCs as well. And by the last DLC, I was like, I'm kind of over this now. But it's a lot of content, to be fair, as well. I played it all in one go. So it was a lot of stuff to get through. But I just think the DLC that inspired it from Borderlands 2, the Tiny Tina's DLC, I can't actually remember what was it, Dragon's Keep or something like that, I can't remember what it was called, but yeah, it was just fantastic. It was totally silly. It was just kind of that random, like, it's just almost like a comedy game, and that's what I'm looking forward to, is just having like a game that just takes the absolute piss out of itself.
I think that's another thing why I really enjoyed Borderlands 2, because obviously at that point I was younger than I am now, and I had a different taste in comedy back then. And now when I look at Borderlands, like, if I was to go back and play Borderlands 2, I probably wouldn't feel the same way about the comedy that I do now, that I did back then.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely, yeah. I think it is a bit, it's like silly humor. It's like, kind of like, it's quite childish humor, if I'm honest, but it suits me.
Bit of bumwilly fart, innit?
Yeah. But sometimes I like that in a game, just having that silly humor and just like it just doesn't take itself seriously at all.
Just basically switch off your brain humor.
Yeah.
That's what I can call it.
Yeah, just absolutely ridiculous.
I was looking out of my window while listening to that, and there's where my flat is, there's a football pitch across the road from me, and I was just looking at the stand, which is called the Willy Boyd stand. And I was literally staring at the word Willy as Duncan said from Willy Fart.
So a lot of things that were announced at the Game Awards are Alan Wake 2. Oh, that's now a survival horror game.
That trailer looks really cool.
Oh, I need to see a trailer for that.
Yeah.
That Plague's Tale Requiem, that looks bloody brilliant. I did pass or play on that, if I recall.
Yeah, that looked really nice.
I gave that a must play, not a pass, what was I saying? Yeah, but they're really the most standout things for me.
Yeah, my one more is Sonic Frontiers, because it looks like the closest we're ever going to get to another Sonic Adventure game. Mm. And Sonic Adventure for me, like growing up, like I've still got a Dreamcast at my setup right now. Growing up, Sonic Adventure was like top tier game for me. I fucking loved that game. And the potential of having a new one.
Watching that trailer give me Halo vibes. I was like, Sonic Infinite.
I was like Sonic Breath of the Wild. That's what I was thinking. I was like, it did look a bit strange. He looked like he was out of place in the environment, but I don't care. If it's anything, if that's as close we're going to get, then I'm going to play it, I'll enjoy it, and then probably put it away and regret playing it. But because every Sonic game that's come out since has been shit.
what about you, Sean?
I've literally just seen the Hellblade trailer, so I need to do a proper catch up tonight. But I was just going to say to Paul, did you like the Sonic film?
I actually did, yeah. I was watching the trailer for it. You know, it's cheesy kind of humor, and again, like the Sonic film, but I did enjoy it, and I have like followed, like Sonic was kind of. I started off playing a Mega Drive, so Sonic for me was one of the first games I ever played, so he's always going to be iconic in my mind. But the thing I liked about the new trailer that they released is, obviously because Knuckles is going to be in the movie, my immediate thought was, like, Knuckles is my favourite character out of a video game ever. Like, for absolutely no reason, and when I played him in Sonic Adventure, I got to punch it all the time and it entertained me. And that's literally it. And, like, I can't wait for all the Knuckles merch. Because I'm just going to... My setup is just going to be covered in Knuckles, I swear. Honestly.
Did you see the Jim Carrey bit at that, where it's like, it's a recorded video of Jim Carrey, and he's like just losing it in the video? That was mental.
Oh, yeah! Yeah, that is so weird. I was like, what is going on?
I was like, am I actually seeing this right now, or am I like dreaming?
Yeah, he was impersonating his Scottish grandfather, like strangling him.
That was crazy.
So, would you be up for a Sonic TV series?
Me, I would eat up anything that's Sonic, even if it's crap. Except from Sonic Boom, that can get in the bin. They ruined Knuckles. They made him look shit, and it pissed me off. But
it's just purely because of Knuckles.
Was a cartoon years ago, wasn't there?
There was loads. So there was the original Sonic the Hedgehog cartoon, which was like kind of your hand-drawn art, kind of like your old school one, where your classic Dr. Robotnik, like, looking like an
this
egg.
That's where all the YouTube poops came from, wasn't it? Because he says, it sounds like he says penis. He says like pingus or something.
I have not seen that.
Oh my god, that was like my whole secondary school was just watching Sonic and Mario YouTube poops. I'm gonna find a clip while you're talking of him saying it. It's so funny.
Yes,
that ought to do it.
That's the Mario ones, isn't it?
And then there was Sonic XD as well. Was that what it was called? The TV series. I actually quite liked that when I was younger, but I haven't watched it since. It's probably crap. But yeah, there's been a few Sonic TV series, but yeah, and then there was the Sonic Boom one, which can just burn. But yeah, I would watch a Sonic series, because that's just the way, like, And also the Sonic Mania mini-series that they released was really cool. I don't know if you've ever seen that, but that was pretty cool. I don't know if you ever played Sonic Mania either. It was brilliant.
I can't really say I'm into Sonic, so I've not really seen anything. I've not even seen the movie.
I got the soundbite, though. And I went, oh, fucking phone's rotated.
Did you hear that? Yes.
So good. Oh, I'm gonna spam you with Sonic YouTube poops now.
Harry will have a go at us if I don't bring it up. Did you see, if you looked at that Matrix experience thing yet, the Unreal 5 engine?
I did, and it was very interesting. God.
Like, watching it, I thought it was really funny, because when I watched Matrix Reloaded, I think it was the second one in the cinema, and that big scene where he's fighting all of the Agent Smiths, like, you know, 200 odds. And I was like, oh my God, this looks so real. I can't believe this is the best graphics I'll ever see. And now I look at it, I'm like, that looks a bit shit now, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And now watching this new Matrix thing, it's probably how I viewed the Matrix Reloaded back then. Yeah, it's amazing to think what's going to come out now with the Unreal 5 engine.
I mean... does that kind of announce that they are working on an actual proper Matrix game again?
I can't remember who said it the other day. They said, imagine a Matrix game made by Rocksteady. And I lost my mind. That would be unbelievable.
Just call it Re-Enter the Matrix.
Oh, that was good, that game, wasn't it? Do you remember that?
Yep. I remember all the cheat codes for it as well.
Matrix Arkham Asylum. That's all you need to do.
I can't wait for the Matrix movie.
I've never seen the Matrix, so I can't comment.
Watch what? It. Oh, they're on Netflix.
Get out.
Jesus.
Get
the fuck out, God.
He ruined it. He's ruined it. All the best, Paul.
Halo TV series. Fucking. Who wants to watch Halo on a TV?
Not really that bothered.
I think it looks really good.
I liked that it was. I liked that Master Chief was in it, because I thought it would just be some fucking knockoff story based on some distant world,
well, like ODST sort of thing.
Yeah,
it's not. It's not canon, and there's a lot of people bitching that it's not canon. Yes, yeah, it's a separate story. They're doing their own thing with the TV series.
Fuck off, then.
Yeah, I've got a thing to say about that though. Like, I'm really looking forward to it, because it's going to stand out on its own. It's going to do its own thing. I don't want to see a rinse and repeat of what we've already played.
No, I suppose so, yeah.
And there's people bitching that it's not in canon, but what they don't seem to understand is we've already had Halo as a story through games. If you want to experience that, go play those games.
It just makes me wonder if it's going to essentially be the same story now, but they're going to change something just to because it's not canon, or if they are going to do like a completely original story.
But I almost feel like, what's the point if it's not canon? Because obviously you're doing all this world building, but if it's not canon, maybe it's just a me thing, but I couldn't be arsed. Because I'm like, well, if it doesn't impact the game or anything, because, I mean, we'll talk about it in a bit, I'm like digging the story mega in Infinite. But if there's an extra bit of content I can go and watch, a bit of it, it's got nothing to do with it, I'm like, I don't know. Unless they're going to rewrite 4 and 5, then in which case,
well, it's going to tell, I guess, the whole story of Halo from the start of the Covenant War till, I guess, near the end of it.
Mm.
And I'm glad it's a separate thing, because I don't want to see Halo again how it was. I want to see something different. I want to experience something new. I want to go into it and, you know, see the unexpected that I've not seen, and hopefully they do that.
Yeah. So I guess it's like we've seen the Spider-Man origin story every fucking film that comes out, or Batman's parents getting shot every time, so yeah, that makes sense.
And that's the beauty of video games. You can play your Halo experience and experience the Halo story we've got as many times as you like. We don't need to see that again, either in TV or film. It doesn't need to be a rinse and repeat. Let them do their own thing with it.
Are you telling me, Duncan, that you are fed up with seeing Bruce Wayne's mum's pearls fall slow motion to the floor for the 50th time?
I love that pearl necklace.
That's a different Batman for a different website, Duncan.
Something else I've been watching, sorry. Sorry, you mean the film, sorry.
That wasn't canon either.
So talking about Halo...
I'm not going to get that image out of my head.
What are all of our favourite Halo experiences? Because we have been quite critical fairly recently of the recent Halo things, but I thought it would be good... if we emphasise the fact that we do actually like Halo. So, Connor, tell us about your favourite Halo bits from the series.
Obviously, the first steps onto the ring in Combat Evolved. That's just an awe-inspiring moment, stepping out of that dropship, life pod, and then like seeing the ring for the first time. Obviously the Warthog runs in both CE and Halo 3. Those are just amazing. The music and racing to the end of the level, trying not to fall off the bloody map, is one of the best things ever in a game. I just love it. Sometimes I'll just load up that last mission, and that really is the only mission I'll load up just to play it, just to race to the end. I love it.
And it's interesting you say about the music, because that's one of my moments, is when I think it's Halo 2. I can't remember the name of the level, like New Mombasa or something. And you're trying to take down a scarab, but it has the Halo theme, but it's that remix with the electric guitar over it. Mm. And I remember just playing it, I thinking, oh my god, this is so badass.
It's just the music pumps you up. Halo is one of them games that the music makes everything so much better. And they go in tandem. The gameplay and the music are one.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess my all-time favorite Halo mission is in Halo Reach, the final mission, Lone Wolf, where you have to basically survive to the point where you just die anyway. And it's one of the best missions ever. It's one of the missions I'll load up as well.
I love that, because it was like, you're almost like not expecting it, because you know Halo's trained you to feel like this, you know, this super soldier badass. And you're like, oh shit, they do die. And it's a proper like gut punch. So yeah, good shot.
Actually, the day Halo Infinite was coming out, I streamed 4 hours that day. 2 hours I played past Halo missions I loved, and then I went on to Infinite.
Yeah. Paul, what about you, mate?
Well, I'm going to be coming from this from a completely different angle, because the first time I ever actually played a Halo campaign was in 2016. So I actually went back and checked through my achievements, because I couldn't actually remember when it was. But yeah, I never really went down the route of Halo until way later on. And the first time I actually played the Halo 1's first, like the campaign, was in 2016. And I played it with a couple of my mates, because they loved it, and they basically bullied me into playing it, and I must say I actually really enjoyed it. Playing co-op campaign was just great fun, and it was, the story is fantastic, but also having the kind of co-op campaign and just having a bit of like a muck about sometimes on a level, just like those little entertaining moments where you just end up like punching each other off the map and stuff like that, because that's what we did. On like, that's the bits that highlight in my brain, is just like, is just having such a good laugh and having fun playing that game together. Because I think the one thing that Halo nails, apart from Infinite, is co-op. Like the co-op, the way that you work together and stuff like that, it's just so much fun experiencing that story together, which I look forward to in Infinite when it does come.
In 6 months.
Yeah.
Soon, TM. Well, before I say my favourites, I was going to say our show finds itself in the very unique position, I just realised the other day, that I think we're the only Xbox-focused like podcast who, when they say something about a Microsoft-owned IP, people don't go like, oh, it's just Xbox fanboys. They go, oh, you just hate Xbox. What? We've made an Xbox-focused show just to shit on Xbox.
There's a little bit of echo in the background I can hear from Sean.
Paul, is that you again?
Is it me again?
For God's sake.
I tried to wear it as a necklace this time.
Don't watch The Matrix. You don't fucking have your echo in
this. Is it echoing still?
It's gone now.
No. Okay, there it is.
Please step up. Apologies.
I've turned it right down.
Can I just do my like one little bit of rant about the multiplayer progression?
We're not on Infinite yet. We'll get there. And then you have your thing. Sean, what's your favourite bit about Halo?
I know how Harry feels now when me and you go off on a tangent, and he's like, he's looking at the time and looking at what's left of the script. I'll try and do one for each one. A favourite bit of Halo 1 was the introduction of the Flood, just because I didn't see it coming. Like, and the sheer number for the technology it was back then, the sheer number of like Flood that come out at you was a bit of a shock, not going to lie. Especially wussy old me, who hated anything remotely like zombie or mutated. Halo 2, probably the same as you, the first scarab moment through the town. And then there's a bit later where it's like quite a steep like sandbank, if I remember right, and you're on like a warthog and you've got to go and take the scarab out. Halo 3, I'm torn. Either again a scarab moment where you're driving around on ghosts and warthogs near the start of the game, or the final warthog run where the music is playing. Absolutely love that. Halo Reach, I would Yeah, I would say the Survive thing as well, just because the whole Halo Reach story I absolutely love. Like it feels like one of the most personal sort of Halo games because of the whole dynamic with the team, instead of just being obviously Master Chief.
Yeah. It's not just that, it's like the sheer desperation to survive and hold the Covenant back for as long as possible.
Yeah, so I think it, and obviously like the one by one they're getting picked off throughout the whole story, so I think that it's like a sort of sad tie-up at the end of it. Halo 4, my favorite bit was the credits, and Halo 5, my favorite bit was the credits.
No, my favorite bit about Halo 5 was uninstalling it.
Yeah.
I'll always say it's the greatest Halo spin-off that never truly existed.
I actually didn't mind Halo 5.
Oh, man. I mean, I really liked you before this episode started.
I know, I'm just here to be devil's advocate.
Yeah, but like once you've played all the Halos and like you've realized how little Master Chief is in a mainline Halo game, it's just weird. Like three missions out of the entire campaign.
It felt to me on Halo, well, to be fair, the entire campaign literally took me about 6 hours, if that, to complete. It wasn't very long. But yeah, I felt like it was almost like they were leading on to doing like a Master Chief game and another game. Like it was like they were almost like leading themselves to making two separate, like almost doing a spin-off again, but like with that storyline. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that it was good. Like I'm not saying it was great. I just didn't mind it. Like I wasn't sitting there thinking, oh my god, this is shit. I was just kind of like, it's all right. Like I kind of got the angle that they went for and stuff like that. I don't think it really fit into the rest of the Halos, because I have played, well, apart from Reach, but I don't need to play that now after listening to you guys. but yeah,
I still advise playing it. It's brilliant.
But I just think like it doesn't feel like it fits into the mainline Halos. But I even remember there was a TV series that went alongside 5, or was that with 4?
It's 5, Nightfall, yeah.
Yeah, I remember watching that as well, because I think I watched it as well because your man out of Luke Cage, and obviously he's in the game as well, and then you've got Nathan What's-His-Face that's in everything.
Nathan What's-His-Face?
Hi, him.
Nathan Fillion.
That's him. He's in everything.
Handsome devil.
He is. He's in absolutely everything. Like, if you pretty much watch any kind of sitcom or something like that, guaranteed he'll turn up at some point if it's an American sitcom.
Also, like, did you see the Uncharted thing that he was in, like, the short movie? Why the fuck wasn't he Nathan Drake in the actual movie?
Yeah, he actually suits that character, like, massively. But yeah, anyway,
we all love Halo then, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Right, Connor, you've got 2 minutes to whinge about the multiplayer. Go.
Right, this is more aimed at people moaning about people that are moaning about progression. Right, look, I just want to say something about this progression and cosmetics to the people that keep saying things like, it's not all about the progression, or it needs to be about the fun again. Don't focus on unlocking shiny things.
15 seconds gone.
No, sorry, I don't accept that. We've had cosmetics in Halo for 15 years. We've been conditioned to like it. It's unacceptable to unlock things at the low rate of speed that we have. Although, yeah, it's been improved a little bit. Halo has got a long way to go before its progression is where it is at, where it needs to be at for the fans. And you can be one of those people that don't give a rat's ass about cosmetics, and I accept that. But it doesn't give you the right to dismiss those that pride themselves on individuality. Because for me and many others, customizing our Spartans is a means of expression. It's how we want to portray ourselves in a game. And that's all I've got to say. So fuck you.
Progression shouldn't only be a fucking battle pass.
You've got another minute if you want, mate.
I was gonna say, Mitch, if that was Crystal, if that was Crystal Maze, you'd be flying out before the door started shutting.
That's what I've got to say. Like, fuck all you wank stains that attacked me on Twitter for the stance I took. It's my fucking opinion.
Absolutely,
I'm entitled
fucking,
to feel the way I want to feel about something. Now go and have a fucking magnum and a huge wank, you salty arseholes. Fuck yous, fucking Twitter wankers.
That is it. I'm standing up. Standing up, Connor.
I've had enough of those people that are saying it's not all about the progression when we've had it in the fucking games for 15 damn years.
I think a good way to sum it up, for people that say it's not about progression, well then one, why is the battle pass the thing that people buy the most, where the sole purpose of a battle pass is progression?
Exactly. And then just shitty challenges that are dedicated to wasting your time.
I've only got one thing to say about it. Now, we know how shit Battlefield is this year. I paid too much money for it. I know it's bollocks. But they've just released their first weekly challenge and to unlock a skin for something. And it encourages players to work with their teammates and play the objective. And that is it. It is so fucking easily done to be like, capture a flag, revive a teammate. And that's it. I still cannot get my head around why.
Oh, no, not in Halo.
Why it was like that. It's so anti fucking. Mate, I don't know. Anti team play.
You're running around the map and you're seeing three of your squad members staring at a fucking wall waiting for a weapon to spawn just because they want to get their challenges done. Fuck off. I've had enough of it. Separate the goddamn playlist, you dickheads.
Oh.
It's not, my problems are not about the gameplay. I fucking love the gameplay. I could sit there and wank over the gameplay. It's the problem I have with everything that is surrounding the gameplay. The fucking playlist being locked to random fucking modes is abysmally shit. Every other Halo game before it had separate modes.
Tune in to episode 48 of Gamers Watch, where I promise we will talk about the campaign of Halo Infinite.
I think we've talked about it enough now. Let's move on, because that was more than 2 minutes.
So, thank you, Flight Connor.
So friendly.
So, next segment is the Halo campaign infinitely better than what we expected.
Did you get it?
Fucking hell. So, I think, yes, is probably what everyone is going to say. I thought we'd just go through, like, each part of it. So the only kind of real whinge that I have about it is the preloading bullshit. So I downloaded it 3 times in the end just to fucking play it. And I was so fucking annoyed by the time I actually got to play it. I was worried. I'm like, well, I'm going to hate it. Because I was really wound up, and I think I put a tweet out, 343 are idiots, because I think they are, and I still think they're fucking idiots. But just pre-release your games, cunts. Like, it just let us preload it. There's no, you can't release a game and say, oh, well, by the way, you've got half an hour to wait if we can play it again. If it's not out at 6 o'clock, don't say it's out at 6 o'clock. It's the same bullshit that we had with Flight Simulator. If it came out at 6 o'clock, you got to download a fucking map pack. Bullshit.
You loaded the game up, you got a patch, it was like a 3 gigabyte or something patch, but then you load the game up again and it tells you you've got a 20-something gigabyte update.
I'd done that, but mine, I downloaded like the couple gig patch and then I told it to install the campaign and for some reason just started downloading everything again, so I had to wait for like
same as me.
50 gigs to download instead of 20.
I turned on my Xbox, it started updating, so I thought, oh well, that's it then, so I'll just turn my Xbox off. Left turn on a couple of hours later, it was on 80%. I'm like, well, I'll leave it on overnight. Went in the morning, hadn't done, loaded up the campaign. It said, download it again. I'm like, well, I've already done this. So I did it again. And then it hadn't actually installed the game. So I had to re-download it a third time. It's just bollocks. It just works. Nah, it doesn't. Same thing we said about Flight Simulator.
The thing for me, like you just said there, this is under a little head and I've got us downloading software issues for actually just getting the game. The no pre-install, 100% agree. That's just ridiculous. Considering that pretty much every game that goes onto Game Pass has pre-install, but the Microsoft flagship game doesn't, that just baffles
really
me.
Weird.
Having to download the game in some weird abstract way of written down because they put out there was a tweet going around about this is how you can do it to not have to download 48 gigabytes. And it's like, well, why do you have to do a workaround? Again, it's Microsoft's bloody game. It's Xbox's game. Why are we required to do a workaround? And the other thing I've got as well is can't quick resume. A feature that is built for the Series X and the Series S consoles, the Halo, a game that was meant to release with these consoles, doesn't support a feature from these consoles. Baffles me. But yeah, that was kind of my key ones there.
We'll get to like 343 a bit later on, but so if we start off with the opening cinematics, we've all got it downloaded, been playing it. Paul, so what do you think, opening cinematic? What are your first thoughts, man?
I thought it was bloody brilliant. It was absolutely stunning visually, and the storyline straight from the beginning, I was totally drawn in. I had goosebumps. I was like, holy shit, this is kicking off. Like, straight away. There was no kind of like gradual build up. It was straight into the actions, and then it was just like slap bang. Obviously, that opening scene with Master Chief, it just had me kind of thrown a little bit, because it's not often that you see Master Chief get his ass handed to him.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It, like, maybe a little bit of a spoiler if anyone hasn't watched The Mandalorian, but it felt a lot like an apology to me from 343. So when you see Master Chief being like a proper badass, like right at the beginning, apology if I'm spoiling it, but it's been out for fucking ages, so I don't care.
Right, it's a shit Halo game anyway. Halo 5.
Oh, no, talking about Mandalorian.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Halo 5.
When Boba Fett came back and he was like destroying stormtroopers, and I was like, yeah, this is what we've wanted for so long. And it felt a lot like Disney and Lucasfilm were apologising for the shitty sequels that we got. And it felt a lot like that, where they'd kind of made Master Chief a bit of a tit, like a bit soppy the last couple of games. And now all of a sudden he's like, it feels like proper Master Chief. Like he's a real fucking badass. Yeah.
Feels like Billy Big Bollocks again.
Yeah, like he's real kind of stoic, like the way he talks.
There is a scene later on in the game as well that I won't say anything about who says it or whatever, but there is a couple of lines that basically feels like it is just 343 talking instead of the character, where it is saying about how made mistakes in the past and learning from it and like realizing that they can't do it alone, sort of thing. I was like,
I know exactly what you're
talking about. This is 343 talking, not the actual character.
I've not seen that bit yet.
I think as well, like, kind of, this is kind of going a bit on from the opening scene, but there is a sense that I've gotten from Master Chief that they've kind of gone a little bit, they've grown a little bit in the story, in the sense that, you know, Master Chief actually speaks, for one, significantly more. Not that he does loads, like, it doesn't take him away from his character, but you can see that the weight of war has gotten to him a little bit, and yeah, I like that.
I really took that as right from the opening, so it echoed the opening of Combat Evolved, where he kind of comes out from the pod, and it's the same thing where you've got the pilot like charging you up again. Yeah. But I mean, I'm not very far into it, so it might very well change. Mm. But loads of like the things that Master Chief says, it's just really short things, like how his famous line, "Finish the fight." Like, he's not going on these big long speeches. He's so like laser focused on the mission, and it really feels like Master Chief is properly Master Chief again. You're like, yeah, he's a fucking badass. Can't wait to fucking play this again. And one of the opening bits where, is it Escherum? Like the brute wolf. He's talking to Master Chief, but then the focus is on the camera on you. And that's very much what Combat Evolved was like. So Master Chief was pretty silent most of it, because you're supposed to be the chief. Yeah. And I feel that's what they're trying to do again with this, is to make you feel like you're a badass. Because in 4 and 5, I correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like he spoke a lot. I feel like it just kind of took away from like the mystery behind Master Chief. Whereas now it's like, it's this 50-year-old, proper war-torn, battered bloke. It just wants to fucking get the job done. And I really, really like how they've turned it back around to proper Master Chief again.
Have you all done that first tower mission?
I literally just did that this afternoon.
There's a point in that when you get to the top of the tower and you fought that elite, I'm assuming.
Yeah, yeah.
And you've got to the other Spartan that's there.
Yes.
Mm.
That moment, you can just see by the way that Master Chief carries himself in the game how fucking pissed off he is.
Yeah. Yeah.
100%.
There's a video that always makes me laugh, which is basically a developer diary from 343 for Halo 4, I believe, and then a developer diary for Bungie. And it's basically a 343 person's like, oh, you know, Master Chief, he's a human under that armor. Like, he's an actual person. He's not just a machine. And it just cuts to Bungie's one where it's like, we didn't want to really flesh out Master Chief because he is just a hulk of metal that the player controls. And I think that's where they went wrong in one of the aspects they went wrong with in Halo 4 and 5 was they tried to humanize him a lot. But with Infinite, it feels like they've like found the balance, so they can have like the human moments, but with the characters like surrounding him, which allows him to stay as Master Chief, like Mr. One-Liner every now and then.
In Purpose of the Law, they were taken as children, the Spartan Twos. They were taken as children, 6-year-old children, taken from their homes and replaced with clones. So they're not going to be like your normal human. They're not going to be so emotional. They're not going to have like tears streaming down their face all the time. They're made to be a weapon. They're made to basically be a fighting machine. That's what they're supposed to be. They don't need to be anything else than that.
How far through are you guys?
I'm not very far.
5 hours into it, but most of that is me doing like forward operating bases and the other like compounds and stuff.
Finished it this morning.
Right,
because <What the hell?
laughs> yeah. I was going to say I'm quite a fair bit through it. I actually thought they humanized more in this than any other one.
The sort of like Halo 4 and 5, they were trying to make him seem human, which was just the like they just took the wrong approach to doing it.
Yeah, they took that emotional side of him and Cortana and kind of really went into depth with that and kind of I felt like though like replaying 5, I was kind of like I felt like every character, every Spartan, it was, is it Blue Team? Is that right? Am I wrong there? Yeah, every character in Blue Team was asking Chief a question and he would just ignore them constantly. like every single time they'd be like, what's the plan, Chief? And it would just like cut to the next bit. So he just wouldn't answer. And it kind of cracked me up. Whereas with this, I feel like the weapon, the new AI, I feel that she's almost the kind of the buffer for his humanity there. Like he doesn't need to be the emotional thing because she's almost got this like innocence because she's a new AI and she's learning and things
she's
like that.
Naive, isn't she?
She's creating the kind of the emotional side of it. So it's taken that away from his character. But I did feel there was moments, particularly with him and the pilot, and I won't go into detail about it, but between him and the pilot, that showed a level of humanity that I don't think we've previously seen in him. And that for me was kind of showing alongside the kind of bit that you mentioned, Connor, about the Spartan, that with that kind of added together, it shows to me that the weight of the war is actually getting to a point with him that he's like, he is kind of getting to this frustrated point that he's like, I need to get this done. We need to see this through. This is one thing after another. And I just need to fucking take his head on. And like, he's just like, I'm going to go straight through the problem. Like, I'm not going to try and go over it, round it. I'm going straight fucking through it. And that's it. And that's kind of, you know, so you kind of got that badass side, but also that kind of, then there was a level for me, and maybe that's just kind of like the subjective view of it. But for me, there was that kind of bit more of an emotional side to it that he was responding to people, whereas in Halo 5, he just ignored everyone.
Yeah, but like the emotions part, to me, I think they've done a job here where it's mostly his body language that shows his emotion. Mm-hmm. You can tell when he's fucking angry just by his body language. You can tell when he's pissed off. A lot of it is not portrayed for him speaking. Like in Halo 5, there was a lot more speaking roles where you could tell he was being more emotion. You could tell it in his voice. You could tell that he was being more of an emotional human type character. But I think what they've done better here is they've scaled that back and they've let you see that in his body language.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that head drop that you said earlier on, Connor, when he finds the Spartan.
Yeah.
When I watched that earlier on, I was like, oh, yeah. It's so well done. Mm. And it reminds me a lot of in Star Wars, the way, like you know, what the fuck was he called? Like BB-8. Granted, it's a more cartoony thing, but how they put a personality into a droid. So the way he kind of nods his head or he does a certain little thing.
The way that people carry themselves or something carries itself.
And that head drop... It was like, oh, he's real. He's right, like, enough now.
He needs to get out of that building and kill some fucking banished. That's how he's pissed off right now.
So talking about killing stuff, probably a bit of an obvious thing, but what do you guys reckon about the gunplay? I think it's great.
It's fucking awesome.
It feels like old Halo. I really love the loop of pulling in the fusion coils and lobbing them at stuff.
I love it.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a few times I've messed that up and accidentally pulled myself towards the fusion coil and blew myself up.
Yeah, the only thing I find a little bit odd, I almost feel like I'm like scraping for ammo quite a lot of the time. I don't know if that's just me not being too aware of...
No, I'm the same.
Halo has always been a bit like that, though. They want you to pick up the other weapons and use the other weapons in different situations. They want you to feel like you need to throw that weapon away and pick something else up because you're like fighting for survival pretty much in a heated situation.
Because I find a lot of the time now I'm just grappling in and punching stuff rather than actually shooting them. But that grappling hook is transformative in how good it is. Okay, because I played a lot of Titanfall 2 and it's brilliant in that, but something about it in this, like just the weight of him and the way he kind of swings towards stuff. And I think John said a couple of weeks ago, he's like almost like can't go back to playing without it, because it's such a good thing.
I'm going to end up using the grapple so much more in the multiplayer now than and in a completely different way, because I feel like I've learned to like playing the multi. You see, I think I would have rather have gone campaign than multiplayer, because I've learned so much from the campaign in regards to movement, because I think movement is such a key factor in Halo. Like, it, you know, you can fire a gun, you know, a lot of people who play video games can aim a gun and fire it, but the way that you move in Halo seems to be the defining factor away from other kind of shooters. Kind of similar in a sense to like how you have to move about in Quake, like, you know, in the kind of Quake multiplayer, you've got to like navigate the map in the right way. And that's what I've had so much fun just kind of approaching things at different angles using the abilities you get, apart from the threat sensor. I think the threat sensor is pretty much pointless in the campaign, if I'm honest.
Oh, it comes in handy. it can come in handy for a few bits.
Has anyone found a single skull yet? Because I haven't.
No. Yeah.
I found one in my entire playthrough. Literally one.
I've got about, I think, maybe four, I think. One I watched, to be fair, I did watch a video on, because I was quite annoyed when I first started the game and got past the first level and I missed one skull and I got really paid off about it, which you guys would have seen in the chat, because I was like, I'm very much the type of person that likes to collect everything in a game. Like, I love going backtracking, but I don't like getting pulled away from the story to do that. I like to go back afterwards and then go and get it after I've gone through the kind of storyline where the linear path has taken me, and then go and collect everything. But, you know, you can't obviously do that with the first two missions, which I kind of fucked up, but that's on me. But yeah, after the first mission, I ended up watching a video on getting a skull. But yeah, I just found some randomly when I was kind of navigating around the map. Like, I'm not seeking them out anymore, because I've got that one that I can't go back and get, so I don't see the point.
If you're going to do a second playthrough, I advise you watching Hidden Xperia's video he put out yesterday on all the skulls.
So on the topic of getting collectibles, obviously there was a lot of debate about, because it's an open world, you can't replay a mission. How do you find like the combat for like a structured mission compared to an open world gameplay? Because I much prefer the kind of internal levels where it's almost a bit more linear. You're in like an arena rather than the open world. I feel like on the structured missions, I get into this real kind of lovely kind of like movement where I'm kind of grappling around and picking up coils and chucking them and nutting grunts and things like that. But whereas on the open world ones, when I'm trying to take a fob or kill a named elite, I find I'm sneaking around a lot more, and I don't find it as much fun as I do like a typical Halo level, as it were.
Yeah, I think the structure is, for combat, the structure is a bit better for the linear levels. The open world feels more like, well, it's more sandboxy, so it's, you take your own approach from any angle, sort of thing. But one of the downsides of that is it's not going to be, they can't design certain ways for the combat to play out, because obviously they don't know where you're going to approach it from, or what sort of weapons or vehicles you're going to have with it. But so yeah, I think the combat in the linear levels is a bit better than the open world, but the open world, I still enjoyed the combat in that, like just being able to do whatever I want.
I agree with that in the sense of the kind of open world kind of levels. The thing I struggle with the open world levels is there's not, depending on where the area is, there's not necessarily a lot of cover, or like you were saying, running out ammo dinks. So I find myself, now I've unlocked the Wasp, so I just basically just whip out the Wasp and just go and just go about the map and just take all these objectives, because it's really easy now. Like, I've gotten a good bit through the game, I've done a lot of it on foot, but I've kind of just gotten to the point, I'm on the last few fobs and stuff like that, and I just got the last one before coming on, and yeah, I'm just kind of going about, I'm just cleaning up the map now with a Wasp, just kind of buzzing about, just taking whatever. But mainly because I find that when you do go in to these areas, it can be quite easy to die. Like, I'm only playing it on normal as well. Yeah. Maybe I'm just not very good at the game, but I do find that I am quite quickly dying, because the thing is, they get reinforcements quite quickly as well, and then you just get spammed by a bunch of enemies in an open area, and that's the thing. There's not a lot of cover. You know, I suppose Halo, when it's the linear missions, it almost has like a platform kind of section to it. Like, you've got like kind of levels in the building and stuff like that that you can kind of go up, and especially with the grapple, you can kind of maneuver about a little bit more. Whereas in the open level, you tend to kind of just have this flat open area, maybe a few trees, maybe some of the pillars. But apart from that, you've not got a lot of kind of option that's kind of either going heavy hitting, and there's not really a stealth option, I don't really feel either. So yeah, I just kind of turned to the wasp and just took out the last couple because I was getting fed up.
I was just saying, the bit that got me the most in the open world was the fucking snipers, because they are undodgeable.
Clumsy
and they're so far away that there's no chance for you to like close in on them beforehand before they get you.
I just carry a battle rifle constantly and you can one shot them.
If you see like a red line on your screen, you're gonna be dead in 2 seconds because they fire 3 shots directly at you and that's it.
Yeah, they spam the 3 shots as well.
Yeah, it's not one shot, a couple of seconds to reload, or you're dead if you don't like do anything. It's literally red line, bam, bam, bam. Oh, load checkpoint.
Yeah, they don't get recoil.
No.
Like, I usually I've got a tradition. I'll go through every Halo in Legendary. I mean, nothing, you know, most people do that. But I have no interest in doing it in the open world, because that's just going to be a horrible experience to do that. Because I'm same as you, Paul. I play it on normal, and I'm like, I'm playing it last night. I'm like, I'm fucking dead a lot. Am I shit? Is it me? I'm like, no. It's just there's just so much going on, and I think, well, maybe it because I've not played a proper Halo in a while. I'm not into the flow of it, and I need to use the grapple hook more, because I'm still very much thinking on like quite a kind of a linear plane, whereas really I need to think, well, I can get out of here quickly by aiming up here and grapple hooking and swinging around. So we touched on a story a minute ago. I really love it so far. Like, I'm surprised at how invested I've got into it quite quickly, because I always found the Halo story was quite difficult to follow. But quite quickly, I'm like really, really digging it. So I really like the weapon. I'm not very far into it at all, so it might turn complete shit. The only thing that I do find a little bit shit, I suppose, is I find the villains a bit hammy, like a bit kind of cartoon villain. So you've got like Escherum, and there was someone else I think you killed quite early on, and they're kind of looking over like a war table, and he's like, "Oh, I'm gonna take over the planet, and no one can stop us now." And it just felt a little bit hammy. But again, that might improve. But I say, so far, I'm really enjoying the story.
I think the story is brilliant. And the one thing that concerned me right at the beginning was, I'd obviously just played Halo 5, which I appreciate not many people like. But I was like, how the hell does this connect? But there is, as you go into it, it does kind of connect the dot a little bit. Well, at least what I've seen so far. And I'm like, ah, that makes sense. And I was quite happy with that. So yeah, the story for me is, I think it's fantastic. The only thing I would say that I dislike about the story missions is that they can kind of lock you out of the free roaming world a little bit sometimes. And I've also read, and I don't know if this is true because I'm not even going to tempt fate by doing it, but if you go to a certain mission at one point and it doesn't warn you, apparently, that you can then be locked out of potentially getting other stuff on the map. So that's a little bit concerning if that's true. But as I said,
like
I don't know if
point
it is.
Of no return kind of mission.
Yeah. And the game, I don't know, Sean, you've completed it. Have you tried going back into your save file? Does it let you?
Yeah. You can carry on in the open world after the game.
Oh, well, what I read must have been crap then.
I'm trying to think of what area it could be. I don't know if there might be one area that you can't get back to.
I can tell you
to
what the mission apparently is, because it's the one that I've been putting off, and I've got Halo on my screen right now. The sequence, apparently, if you don't do stuff in the map before the mission called the sequence. This is what I read, right? I'm not saying it's true, but I read it, and right. I think that's a thing. Like, my difficulty with not being able to go back through the missions, and kind of going back and getting things. Like I was saying, I kind of got locked out in doing that first mission. I couldn't go back and get that thing. Is I do have this underlying anxiety that I'm like, I want to do everything that's a side mission now before doing anything that's a main mission. It's kind of like, it's almost kind of locked me out of doing the story a little bit, because I'm like, I'm so worried that if I go and carry on the story now, I'm going to not be able to go back and do these things. And I want to do all these things. So I've just made that my priority and kind of put the story on hold.
So you will be able to go back and do everything, but if you don't want to wait a while to be able to do everything again, I would do it before you do that sequence mission.
Right, okay.
There is a lengthy time where you're not doing anything but story after that bit.
Yeah, and that's kind of what I was saying about the story sometimes locks you out of the open world. And yeah, it's a bit, that's a little bit frustrating, but I feel like I've been sounding very negative. I bloody love this game, and I've put so many hours into it already, and I've almost done everything that is visible on my map. Like, I've literally got like two more things to do, and then I'm going to carry on the story. Like, I'm pretty obsessed with this game, and it gives me, and again, just to make Halo fans probably hate me, it gives me massive kind of like Far Cry 3 vibes in regards to the open world and kind of like doing those kind of bases and liberating those areas, and then, you know, with the fobs, it scans the area and shows you where the collectibles are in that area. That kind of Assassin's Creed, almost style, early Assassin's Creed, that kind of stuff, it's given me those vibes, and I love going through it and just trying to find everything in those games.
I feel like it's like a very scaled back sort of Far Cry type situation with the open world, and
yeah,
I think I like that more than Far Cry, because I don't really play the Far Cry games. The last Far Cry game I played was 4, and I never completed it.
Yeah, I think Far Cry is a bit rinse and repeat with their missions. Like, they are very, like, you feel like you're doing the same thing 100 times, whereas this doesn't necessarily feel like that. Each one feel, and I kind of noted this down as well, I said that the side objectives on the map are fun and diverse and give a sense of feeling that you're contributing to the overall goal in the story. Like, and I totally stand by that. It feels like everything that you're doing in the map has a purpose for the overall story to me. Like, it makes sense, it fits in. Whereas I think with games of, like, you know, as I was saying, Assassin's Creed and Far Cry, sometimes you just feel like you're doing it because they've just put it in the map just to kind of pad it out. Whereas it doesn't feel like that in this.
Yeah, I think also, talking about story, I think from the sounds of it, I might be the only one that's happy on the story, because I love the characters. Like, I can't fault the way they've done Chief and the weapon pilot, and I really like the Banish in this. Like, they feel like a proper hulking threat.
Yeah, they feel like a more fleshed out villain as well. Like,
so yeah, I think just because they're more present throughout the game, whereas in the old ones, like, even the Prophets, they're just not there for a good few missions and then they'll just turn up in a cutscene.
Yeah.
But I really like the story that's there, but I'm trying to think of a way to describe it without potentially spoiling anything. The majority of the story is basically describing how you've got to the point at the start of the game, like, right, that, okay. And then there's a few lines and tidbits scattered here and there that, while playing it, I was like, oh, I can't wait for this reveal. This is going to go somewhere. And it's basically the lines they fed to sell you as expansions later on.
I've noticed that, because there was a mention earlier when I was playing it about, and this isn't a spoiler, I don't think, but the weapon talks about a certain enemy type that's on the field and says that we'll see them again on another ring. And I was like, what? Nah. So it's definitely leading to
it
more.
It makes sense. They have said it's going to be a 10-year plan. There will be DLC. It's obvious.
It's obvious, but at the same time, there's no story past the starting point of the game, sort of thing. Like, the story of the game is figuring out and recalling what happened in between Halo 5 and the start of Infinite. If that makes sense.
Yeah, that doesn't bother me too much. I'm kind of all for that, because, like, they do a lot of that with the extended lore in the books, and not many people want to read the books to know what's happened.
Yeah, and I get why they're doing it, but at the same time, they're going to charge you £20 for each expansion.
I guess it's not, like, satisfying.
It's clear. One of the lines they've done in, I'm pretty sure they've done in the trailer, so it isn't actually a spoiler, is about an enemy, and the weapon says, what can possibly be worse than the Flood? And Master Chief says, nothing good.
I have an idea of what
you never find out what that is. Never see the nothing. It's That is an expansion that they're going to sell to you.
I've like caught up on a lot of the lore lately, so I kind of know what that is, but don't want to say what it is because for obvious spoilers.
Well, if it's
for
not in the if it's not in the game, then I'm quite happy for you to say what it is. Because it is, at the end of the day, it's just theory right now, isn't it? So
it's my theory because I'm only 5 hours in. I've not really done a whole lot of the story. Most of my experience so far has been mopping up forward operating bases, which I've been thoroughly enjoying. But with you saying that, my theory is that it's the primordial.
That's, yeah, it's going to be something to do with that. And that's, that leads me on to something else that I'll explain a bit later when we talk about like open world bits and that. But I don't know. I just feel I get that they need to set up more if they're doing a 10-year plan. But I also feel like they need to have a story in the base story, if that makes sense. Yeah.
So how do you reckon that 343 can handle it? So like, I mean, I still have my doubts. I mean, I'm loving it. I'd be lying if I said I didn't. But with everything with the multiplayer and what you've just said about how the story pans out, do you feel confident that 343 are going to smash it in future games, or are you like me and wish Bungie never left?
I do wish Bungie never left because I still think they'd do a better job. But I think, I don't know, I'm torn now because it's going to come down to whether the things that I don't like about the campaign are due to time constraints. Or if it's like if they genuinely planned for it to be like that and thought that was a good idea to start off what they're going to then do in like paid expansions years down the line sort of thing.
I can't really speak too much myself, obviously, because I've not completed it like you have. But with Joseph Staten coming back, is it really that much of a big worry considering how much he was ingrained into Halo's past?
I don't actually know who that is. Was he a Halo Bungie guy, was he?
He's wrote a lot of the Halo games. He's like the...
Okay.
He worked on Halo 1 through 3, did he not?
Right, okay.
So I guess with you saying that, I don't really have worries because I kind of have a lot more faith in Joseph Staten to pull it all together. And maybe this is why this is like that, because now he is on board. Mm. He can put things where they need to go, where he feels they need to go, because he's pretty much the Halo lore master.
It's probably
343 now.
It sounds a lot like how I feel about Battlefield now, because Vince Zampella has been put in charge of Battlefield, and now it's almost a bit like a football manager, I suppose, that like people would get a lob on over Jose Mourinho managing someone because he was the best manager, even though he's a dickhead. But it's almost like how we feel about like game developers. So like Vince Zampella and Joseph Staten, like now they're heads of our favourite things. We kind of feel happy. It's quite funny how it kind of translates across.
I suppose it just gives you a little bit more faith that they're not going to fuck it up as bad as they have.
Yeah. Can I just like cycle back to the opening cutscene? I loved how that was like heavily Star Wars space battle inspired.
Mm.
That like opening moment of the ships colliding felt like a opening moment of like a Star Wars movie.
Mm.
And I loved that. I thought that was really interesting that they pulled that sort of thing into Halo.
Yeah, I think wasn't it, they done the whole thing where it was like a muffled noise at first, wasn't it, as well, where it's like slow motion because it's obviously in space, and then they'll and cut into the ship.
I was surprised to see that Atriox was in the opening cutscene as well.
Just destroying Master Chief, slamming him against warthogs.
What? I might have missed something out here, but what actually happened to him? Do you find that out in the story, Sean?
Yes. That's what I mean. The story, the vast majority of the story is basically finding out what happened between the ending of Halo 5 and you being found by the pilot.
So I found it really strange that they obviously, you know, they showed this vulnerability of Master Chief right in the opening cutscene, which I thought was amazing because he's always been shown as like indestructible, and obviously he survives so much, and then he gets his ass handed to him. And I think that really gave weight to the enemy that you're about to face. You know, it really showed how powerful and like how difficult this is going to be. This is going to be a hard fight to win. But then obviously their leader, Atriox, you then don't even see him through, like, I'm definitely more than 50% through the game, and I just think that's a really, like, and then they talk about obviously he sacrificed himself or something like that in the story, which I don't feel is really a spoiler because it's just a narrative that's in the background. I don't really understand why they went down that angle of taking this big badass that just put Master Chief in his place and then just ditching him.
What I liked about that moment where Atriox and the Chief are fighting is it made me feel like like Master Chief can die now.
Yeah.
And obviously I haven't completed the game, so I don't know what the fuck happens later.
Yeah, you'll find out. It is good. Like, I know it sounds like I'm shitting on the story, but the story that is there, I absolutely love, and it is done perfectly. The middle bit's a bit sluggish, but like when it starts wrapping up, it's really good. It was just after the credits, I was sort of sat there, I was like, nothing really happened to the point past where I got found. Like, it was all just about what happened in between Halo 5 and me being woken up from Deep Space Leia style.
That sounds interesting to me, though, because I kind of want to piece all that together throughout the story, and that, to me, it appeals to me.
Yeah, it's good. It's just I wish there was a present time story running at the same time sort of thing, rather than teasing you of what you can buy later as an expansion.
I'm just hoping that they don't, like, fuck people over with those expansions, and they're, like, astronomically priced. I'm hoping that it's all included in Game Pass, like they did with the Gears of War DLC.
Yeah, I can see the expansions being part of Game Pass, because it'll be like Destiny 2 was, because I think that's just been taken off
now. Just taken off, yeah.
Where the expansions like are included.
High Busters DLC, where it's included. I'm hoping it's like that.
Yeah. I don't think they will. We'll obviously just have to wait and see, but I don't think they will. And I think, and the reason I believe that is because the way this has gone so far, and, you know, not to talk about the multiplayer, but with that being heavily monetized, I don't know if we will. I think they'll kind of be like, this is the baseline game, now buy the DLC, and that's going to be their selling point. And they're going to have a lot of money to make back on this game, because obviously the delay and stuff and the amount of development time. I imagine, you know, I don't know. I can't see it personally.
Especially as they haven't kind of released a special edition or a deluxe edition, which includes all future content. So it's a little bit smoke and mirrors at the minute. But yeah, I mean, so far, I'm a bit kind of on the fence about 343. Like, very much think Infinite is brilliant. But I'm also, it's taken them 10 years to get to this point, and everyone's got an opinion. I personally feel like they fucked up the multiplayer with how they've delivered it. So for me, the jury's out on 343. However, Infinite is a banger.
I think I'm gonna have to wait and see what the expansions are like, because obviously there'll be no excuses sort of thing for the expansion. Whereas with the campaign now, they could be like, oh, time constraints a little bit, which I kind of understand. But I think if I had to sum up Infinite's campaign, it'd be great, but and as weird as it sounds, kind of played safe, or like a lack of variety, I guess. So like the thing I was saying with the open world was all of, apart from the whole like one biome thing, all of the objectives to do in the open world are pretty much identical to each other. Like, and you're supposed to be on Zeta Halo, which is the most infamous, mysterious Halo out of them all. Like, it's one of the original Halos, and it's the only one that remains as part of the like current array they've got. You've got the I can never remember the name, but it's the one that Connor has a suspicion about.
Primordial.
Yeah, he was on the ring and controlled it for like in the lore for like ages, and you wouldn't think that any of this stuff has happened throughout the history of this ring, because there's nothing there apart from the banished light structures.
So the thing is, most people are not going to know what that is, because a lot of people out there haven't read the Halo books.
No, I know, but I just thought it'd be cool to like introduce them to it if you're going to then introduce these like characters later on. Like, for example, the armor lockers and the Spartan cores, instead of just doing the easy, safe way of having them as collectibles scattered around the map, have like a little forerunner ruin underground or something. Or you have to, I know puzzles aren't a thing in Halo, but even if to like solve a quick puzzle and then you get this piece of armor to wear for your Spartan in multiplayer at the end sort of thing.
Yeah, there was like things like that in Halo 3. You had to do one certain thing to activate one of the skulls to be able to get it. Like, you have to jump through literally hoops.
Yeah, the Halo rings. Order, wasn't it?
Yeah, in a certain order. If you did the order wrong, you have to start it all again.
But yeah, just stuff like that to introduce a bit of lore to people that don't know the lore, to also create some variety instead of just having to drive around the map. Because what I'd done in the end, for I think I got like roughly half of the things by the time I finished it, and then I just went around in a wasp at the end and was like, oh, stop here, get that crate, fly off, stop here, get that crate. But it would have been so much better if there was like little ruins or tidbits of lore as well, instead of just banished everywhere.
Has anybody got the, you know, those portal things that you've got to scan? Has anybody gotten enough of them? Yeah, because I wonder if that kind of has some of that. But that's a long road.
No,
to get.
You get an audio log for each one. That's it.
I do have a question to ask you. When you got to that first forward operating base after you come like up from underneath the Halo ring and it goes into the open world thing, did any of you go on top of that UNSC frigate?
No.
There is a fucking button on top of that thing, and I pressed that fucking thing, and there is not a sound cue, not a hint of whatever the fuck that button does. And I'm sitting there scratching my head like, what does this fucking thing do? What the fuck does that button do?
What happened to me when I first emerged like onto the ring was I saw it and I thought it was going to be like Combat Evolved, where you sort of, it gives you time to take all these sights in and like just sort of sit there for a little while and then move on. And I sat there, looked, and then about 30 enemies spawned on me and I just got blown to smithereens. I was like, that was that moment of peace quickly diminished.
A lot of my experience with it so far has been, that's tall, I want to climb it.
that's the one thing, or the main thing they have got spot on in this open world is the scale of like different buildings and environments.
It's just fun flinging yourself about with a grapple hook and seeing how high you can get. Like, that's what I've just really enjoyed, is just like, just basically being Spider-Man.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, I'm looking around to see where these like high locations are, and if I can reach them, I want to use the grappling hook to try and get to the top of it.
Yeah.
Sean, how are you for time? Because I know you've got to leave relatively soon.
Yeah, probably about 20 minutes I've got left.
I still want to like for it to go too long.
I'll just walk off halfway through, but I'll go work now.
I mean, I can't really talk much about the campaign story because I've not got that far in it, mainly because I'm trying to go through the game as at my own pace, like especially on stream as well, because that's the only time I'm playing it is when I'm on stream. I've not touched the campaign at all other than being on stream.
Yeah, I'm very much like Paul in the sense that if I have like an open world game like this and Far Cry, I want to do all the little bits before I do the actual story. But I'm just a bit worried that I'm already getting a little bored of it. I don't know if that's me, but the open world, I'm just a bit, I feel like I've seen it all within the first couple of hours.
That's what I mean by the lack of variety. Like, I wish there was, instead of just, oh, here's 7 banished outposts that you need to like destroy, I wish it would be like 3 banished outposts and then there was like 2-4 run of ruins that are basically mini dungeons of their own sort of thing.
Yeah, if they added like little dungeons then that would have been epic actually. That's a really good point.
Like if you put someone that had never played Halo, like didn't know a thing about the story, if you plonked them on the open world that they've got in Infinite at the moment and asked them who inhabited the ring and what was the history of it, they'd be like, or the Banished created it, I'm guessing, because they're everywhere. Like, actually, there's about millions of years worth of lore in this ring. It's just that none of it's shown.
I think like with the like little side missions and that as well, they do sometimes just kind of feel like you're doing like horde survival for like 5 minutes, and then you complete that area, and then it's like, oh, you've got it. Now you can do another one. I do feel like in the open world it is a bit of an enemy spam sometimes. Like you just feel like you're kind of like, you just got loads of enemies just spawning right next to you, and then the big ships come in and they just like shoot you to fuck and that's my head. Well, and I'm
drop pods on top of you. And you
yes. Yeah, I've had a few drop pods on the head. Like
one of the thing I do like is the targets. Like I love the fact that they all have their own like individual more powerful version of a weapon. Like there's a plasma pistol you can get, the unbound plasma pistol, and that's more powerful than a normal plasma pistol. And then there's like a sword you can get from an elite, which is a more powerful energy sword.
One of the things as well that I feel they've got right with the open world, and it's something that it's a problem that I run into a lot in open world games, is it's really well spaced out, the different side objectives and like little bits you can do. So there's oftentimes in open world games where I'll be like, all right, I've got this thing left to do. Oh, it's going to take me fucking 2 minutes of traveling to get to it. Whereas with Infinite, I don't think I ever like had to go more than 20, 30 seconds of just driving along to get to what I wanted to do.
even traveling like a kilometer in that game with a grapple hook is so easy because you can just fling yourself about the map. Like that's what I that's one thing I really like about the grapple is just being able to traverse the map like so easily without feeling like you're just going to have to run endlessly for days. Like you can just basically spam the grapple and just pull yourself along. And like I use trees all the time and just slingshot myself from trees, like, and just kind of send myself flying as far as I can.
Spider-Man or something.
Yeah,
I've not experienced that. Like I guess I'll call it travel fatigue in a game like this where it's open world, where I get like this to this point where I'm like, oh, I just want to fast travel now.
Not fucking Skyrim.
I had it on Horizon when I was playing that start of this year, I think it was. That like towards the end, I was like, oh, I'm just gonna fucking start quick traveling everywhere because it's just a pain in the ass. But I didn't have that with Halo because everything was quite well spaced out. One thing that I just remembered as well about the open world, there's I'd say a fairly big chunk of it that, and I don't know if this is clicked when I finished the last FOB, so I don't know if it's clicked with you yet, Paul, is that a large chunk of the map isn't open world.
Oh yeah,
and it is very deceiving.
Yeah,
they did kind of say it's not really an open world game though. It's more of a semi open world.
It is. It's like a half and half. That's the way I've kind of picked that. Is that it does feel like a half and half. But I know exactly what you're talking about, Sean. Is that it does appear like it is more than what it actually is.
Yeah, I started because I got the achievement for doing all the FOBs, and then the achievement for oh shit, what was the other one? The like outpost things. And I was like, oh, man, I've got a whole quarter of the map I haven't fucking explored yet. And then it started clicking on me that that is, either, like you said, either going to be DLC, reserved for DLC, or it's a pure like story area.
I imagine like the DLC will explore more of that ring. Like, I think that's kind of... If it doesn't, then I'm going to be pissed off at the little things that they've mentioned, like lore-based things that, like you're saying... like worse than the Flood, you know, they've got to do more on that area. But yeah, there is like exactly that, like there is bits that you're kind of like, oh, I thought I could go there. I've hit a few invisible walls.
I think you're very much gonna, I imagine for the majority of Halo Infinite's life, you're very much gonna be on Zeta Halo because the campaign, it only takes place on that little bit that's broken on the hologram thing. That is where the game takes place.
The other thing I found interesting as well, and it says this in the game, and it could be a little bit of a spoiler, but it talks about, stop me if it is, it talks about repairing. You know what I'm talking about? Would that be a spoiler?
I don't know. I can't remember if they mention it in the trailers or not. The Reformation.
Yeah, basically, but what I'm saying is I wonder if through time with updates and stuff like that and like DLC, if we'll see little bits that we can't access now being accessible because there's been like some sort of repair.
Well, they do like the Destiny route where the actual game world changes as each update comes out, sort of thing.
That's kind of what I mean, yeah. I'm trying to be quite coy in the way I say it. I don't want it to be a spoiler. It's not, I don't really feel like it is, but it kind of is.
I imagine that's the route they're going to go. It's like some bits will change.
And with it being a 10-year game, I kind of expect that.
Yeah, some bits will change, new areas will open, sort of thing. And then those new areas will change on further updates.
One thing that really stands out to me in regards to like the FOBs and stuff I got is that it's so clearly built for co-op, but it's just not there. Like, you know, you've got your four gun stands and stuff like that. And the one thing that I find, and I don't know, like, because I just obviously played Halo 5, I can't remember their names. Again, not a long time Halo player, but what are the big massive things that fire the green like pulse gun at you? What was that?
Hunters,
yeah, right. You see, we're doing that on Halo 5 when you've got your three AI, even though they're fucking terrible. They kind of distract them so you can get round to the back of them and blow off their shields and their spikes or whatever that is on the back so you can kill them easier. It is a fucking nightmare if you're not on your own in this.
Yep, that was the beauty of co-op in Halo.
The hunters are a pain in the ass.
We probably need to move on because we're running out of time. Paul, in 20 seconds, give me your favourite thing about Halo Infinite.
Oh, Jesus. 19.
Or just a summary.
17.
Yeah, I think Halo for me is fundamentally brilliant. It's missing some little bits. I'm not gonna kind of cover that up, but it is great fun. Doug, you put me off counting. That's it. I'm done.
Give me a score out of 10. Quick, go now, immediately. Why haven't you given it to me yet?
I would give it 7.5.
Great, thanks, Connor. You go. 20 seconds.
Because I've not got that far, I'd say the opening has been my favourite moment so far, and I would rate it nothing at the moment because I haven't completed it, and I won't rate a game until I've completed it.
Okay, cool. Sean.
Great game, but not quite perfect because it's played very safe and a lack of variety in blitz. I'd say B+ game. That's a nice little spot for Halo Infinite right there.
Cool. And I don't have an opinion yet because I kind of haven't completed it. Game of 60 seconds.
Game in 6, game in 600, game in 6, game in 600.
You're going to lose, you're going to fucking lose. You're going to lose, you're going to fucking lose. So oh, God. You might need to help me with this, Sean, because I can't remember most of the answers. Last week, we had Harry's old balls.
Yeah, it was, if I remember right, it was, these balls are old and nobody expected that.
I can't remember that, the fucking life of me.
That was Dragon Age Inquisition.
Oh, bollocks.
Jesus Christ.
Why was that a Dragon Age Inquisition?
Because dragon, as in dragging your balls because they're old.
I just wanted you to say it.
And then nobody expects the Spanish Inquisition. Jesus Christ.
I'm glad I'm not doing Game of 600 for that one.
I can't do the clue again for some reason, but mine was Wank Pop Ash It 2. And that is Banjo-Kazooie. Sean, go for your clue, mate.
Mine was a Photoshop of me and Harry sat at a table on a date, and I said, you're breaking up with me, but I was your first. And then Harry said, yeah, but not my last. Lol, okay, bye. And that was X01, because it's X number one, X01, X01.
Zoe said Crossman is the bomb.
Yeah.
Crossman is the bomb. And that was Atomicrops. Thanks.
Because a Crossman is a farmer. Is that right?
I didn't know what a Crossman was when she said it.
I never heard the word before. But...
Still used to live in the country.
Yeah. Right. Have Paul and Connor, have you got a clue for us this week?
I do. Paul, right. You want to go first?
Yeah. Connor, you go first.
I'll go first.
Hit me.
All right. Ready? Yeah. My general practitioner is an absolute machine. My general practitioner is an absolute machine.
All I can think from that is Dr. Robotnik.
No.
Yeah. That's literally all I got.
It's not.
No. Anyone got any clues?
No.
No?
Nah.
Doctor.
No?
Not straight off the top of my head, no.
GP.
You want me to say it one more time? I'm
guessing something to do with GP.
My general practitioner is an absolute machine. And that is...
Oh,
fucking hell.
Jeez.
Very good.
Oh, not think of that.
Bamboozled us. Paul, you got one?
I've kind of got two. I've got the picture clue that I made for last time, but I was too late and the podcast ended. But so I can drop that in the chat if you want.
Do it immediately. Okay. You done it yet?
I need to find it. You need to stop rushing me.
So much more pressing as a host.
So I do mine while you find it.
Imagine he was a wedding planner.
I'm always working to a deadline. Oh, you got it now?
No, I don't have it.
Unbelievable. I completely forgot Harry's answer from last week, so mine's going to be really shit. How old is your mother-in-law? How old is your mother-in-law?
What?
Anyone?
No.
I have no idea.
No, I'm drawing a blank with that. How old is your mother-in-law?
How old is your mother-in-law?
Do you want the answer? Is it?
Yeah, I completely fucking forgot what Harry's one was last week. It's the wrong time, really. Paul, have you done it yet?
You found that picture, Paul.
No, I'm looking.
Unbelievable.
I can't remember where I fucking saved it.
Because we like to finish on Sean.
Sean, why are you late for work? Oh, because my friend Paul, who lives in Scotland, couldn't find a picture to send me in time.
Couldn't find his game in 16.
Can I just describe it and then send it in, and then that'll save time?
Can do.
We've got a choice, have we?
Right, one second. I know absolutely.
This is great video
one
content.
One place it is.
Fuck me.
Audio content. I put in Paul Show Bance, didn't I?
You're doing it on Twitter, you loon.
No, I've put it in there already, I'm pretty sure.
Oh, you did? Let me see if I can do it. Oh, I've got 70 notifications.
Oh, we talked too much shit. When was the date of the last recording? It definitely wasn't fucking October. I've gone way too far.
I can't keep track of the amount of chats we've got on Twitter. It drives me mental.
I'm going to put a 3 hours later thing in here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fucking hell, I'm all the way up in November now. What the fuck?
Have you got a verbal one you can tell us, Paul?
Oh, but I want this one. It's so good.
Yes, we all want this one, Paul.
Yes, I found it. I found it. Yes!
Please say you're leaving this bit in.
Yes.
But where are you putting it?
And that's not the first time that has been said.
Today. Take a little lunch break. Oh my god, Paul.
It won't work, so I'm just sending a screenshot on my bloody screen.
Oh my god.
It won't download the photo, it's downloaded some weird format. Fuck you, Twitter.
Copy and paste.
There you go.
Fucking hell.
I'll get the original for you. So we just got Sean popping out of a toaster.
But the toaster's got nothing to do with it.
Absolutely nothing. And neither does the mug, the toast,
or Sean. Actually, nothing in the picture is relevant to the clue, yeah.
It's just the arrow and it's the movie Up.
Any guesses?
I Am Bread.
Nope.
No, I have no clue.
That is...
Oh, fucking hell, fuck me.
Fuck you.
Jesus Christ. Oh my god.
I can't wait for that.
Oh.
And you gonna fucking go at me about Astria Ascending, yeah? I get this shit.
Oh god.
I actually have a normal one as well, which is all those kids care about is the sound of their own voice.
First thing I thought of was,
yeah, that's what I was going to go for.
Bang on. Yeah, that's it.
Thanks for coming.
Sorry for taking up so much of your time, Dan.
Beat yours quicker than you beat ours.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Game in six seconds.
We're going to win.
Are we ready to offend?
Yes. Oh, always. Wake up ready to offend.
Wake up with fists clenched. It will be with you. In 3, 2, 1, bam.
Oh, it's so good.
What the fuck? It's a cone. And a bunch of Australians holding an Australian flag. Cone Ooh. Plus Australians.
Oh, close. Close.
Oh, I have no fucking idea.
I can't get in my head that it's something to do with time zones, because you're always slacking off their time zones. Oh, wait, is it something to do with criminals?
You know, when Sean sent it to me, I was like, hey, criminals?
It's payday too.
I have no fucking idea. What is this?
Yeah, oh, just God. Tell us.
Okay. This is.
Oh my god! This makes so much more sense now. What the fuck? Well, the Australians are not going to appreciate this one.
Oh, I'm never going there. I'll get lynched. Oh.
So good.
It's going to send you a bunch of venomous creatures. Never open a PO box.
Harry said he's got an Australian guest he wants to get on as well, doesn't he? So I'm not sure how that's going to go down.
I'll play nice that episode. I'll take the piss out of New Zealanders for them.
All the rings were shit.
You're all a bunch of midgets.
Well, thanks, Mark. do you want to do the outro bit, Sean? I'm not ringing.
Yeah, maybe 2 seconds. Get the script back up. Let's start with the guests, I guess. Connor, tell everyone where they can find you.
You can find me on Twitter, the_general_C, and that's my Twitch channel name as well. And you can also find me on YouTube, the General C. I really do need to get back to making parcel play soon, but I've been feeling demotivated.
And also big, streaming.
A big fan of the Twitch though, mate. It's really good.
Yeah, it is.
A good time just to switch it on, play a game or two, and just, you know, just relax and not worry about editing videos. But I do love editing videos, and I need to get back to that. Just need to get motivated again.
Get it done after Christmas.
Yeah. I'm sitting on 2 episodes that I need to just record. It's Back for Blood and Forza Horizon. And obviously, we'll have Halo at that point.
You've got 3 games now to do.
Yeah, so Halo is going to be a pass or play.
I thought you said Halo's going to be a pass then.
No. It's anyway. Going to be a parcel play episode.
Paul, for people who don't want to drive up to Scotland, where can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter at Paul Tire Gaming, or you can find us also under Thistledew Gaming and on YouTube under Thistledew Gaming.
Sweet. And as in Harry tradition each week, thank you for joining us, Duncan.
Thanks. Great, mate. So I was just completely zoned out for a sec. I've got so many fucking Twitter notifications, and this human centipede GIFs are in it. What the hell? Just before we go. So some silly Twitter knobheads was banging on about how Hellblade doesn't look as good as Last of Us 2. And my favourite response at the minute to anyone is like, when you die, Sony won't care, so stop eating their arsehole.
I saw that. I took a screenshot of it. I did want to mention it on here.
And then... And like, there's so many gifts. People having their ass smacked. It's human centipede gifts on there. What the fuck is going on? Twitter. What the hell? Burn it.
Oh, guys, I found the original toast photo.
Oh, Jesus Christ!
It doesn't matter now, does it?
No, we're literally a catchphrase away from
even
finishing.
A different time zone up there. So... Yeah. Oh, thanks for that, Paul. Oh. Yeah, cheers. I guess we'll sleep with that, then, shall we?
Yeah, that's right.
Thanks. Thanks,
keep on listening.
Keep on gaming.
Keep on gaming.
There we go.
Yeah.
Cheers, bye.
Battery.
Hello.